I believe every person has a right to basic knowledge of how to optimize their mind, body, and spirit. Here, I bring to you influential individuals and ideas to help you live a more healthy, fulfilling life. I'm Julie Fouché, and I'd like to welcome you to Pursuing Health. Welcome back to episode number 17 of Pursuing Health. In this episode, I sit down with the Starrett super couple to discuss their nonprofit organization, Stand Up Kids. Juliet and Kelly Starrett each have very impressive athletic backgrounds. Juliet won 2 world championships and 5 national titles on the U.S. women's extreme whitewater team, and Kelly also paddled whitewater slalom canoe on the U.S. canoe and kayak teams. Their love of paddling in the outdoors brought them together, and they've taken the world by storm ever since. Kelly and Juliet founded San Francisco CrossFit in 2005. At that time, Juliet was working as an attorney, but she ran the business side of the gym. And Kelly also ran his physical therapy practice there. Kelly developed his CrossFit Movement and Mobility course and began to teach it all over the world. Together, they eventually founded MobilityWad.com as a way to bring education to people all over the world about movement and body maintenance. Kelly has consulted and worked with the NFL, NBA, MLB, NHL, professional soccer teams, major university athletic programs, as well as all branches of the military. His book, Becoming a Supple Leopard, was published in 2013 and became a New York Times and Wall Street Journal bestseller. His second book, Ready to Run, was released in 2014, also making the New York Times bestseller list. Kelly and Juliet have been using and talking about standing desks for years, but it wasn't until observing their children's elementary school that they realized the potential impact that standing desks could have. In April of 2015, they officially launched StandUpKids.org, a nonprofit and educational platform with a goal of bringing standing desks to all public school children in the U.S. Before we dive into this fascinating conversation, let's review a couple of reminders. Number one, if you're enjoying the podcast, please head over to iTunes to subscribe and give it a rating. Number two, you can head over to my website, juliefouché.com, and subscribe there to stay in the loop with the podcast and everything else I'm doing with my newsletter every 2 weeks. I'm also always looking for inspiring stories to share. If you or someone you know has used lifestyle to overcome a serious health challenge, please send me your story at info@juliefouché.com. If you're interested in training with me, check out my program through Beyond the Whiteboard. This is the actual training that I do now, 5 days per week, 1 hour per day, scheduled out for you minute by minute from warm up to cool down. For more info or to try out the program yourself, visit beyondthewhiteboard.com/Julie Fouché or listen to podcast episode number 12. So with that, let's get started here on Pursuing Health with episode number 17 with Juliet and Kelly Starrett. So I am here with Kelly Starrett and Juliet Starrett, and I'm really excited to talk about some of the things that you guys are working on now. But just to give a little bit of background, why don't you talk first about your own athletic backgrounds and then how you got to what you're doing today? Oh, in the short Cliff Notes version, please.
Kelly's a football player. He loves it when I say that.
Actually, it's a good way to come into this because Juliet and I met at the World Championships for whitewater paddling. She was on the U.S. women's team and I was on the U.S. men's team. We were in Chile. The women had just pulled over to scout a really big, scary, terrifying rapid, and the men didn't need to scout because we had scouted like 3 miles up.
And because they're men. And they're totally awesome.
The short story is that we got chundered, like offline and just brutally chundered, and Juliet came down and rescued me. She literally pulled me out of the water.
Oh.
Yes, him and his $250 paddle. Or a $500 paddle or whatever.
He saves the paddle too?
Yeah, of course. Juliet's such a baller. And from that moment on, I was like, it's love. But I think what you know, Juliet and I had a significant history running rivers and being raft guides.
Okay.
And river guides and wilderness guides. And I think that, you know, kind of leads us to how we got here today about taking risk and being responsible for big groups. And, you know, we have been doing this a long time.
You know, I started off originally in high school as a rower. So okay. I did that in high school, 2 years in college, and then I switched to all river stuff. So that's how I spent 10 years of my life, was on rivers.
Wow.
And Kelly did actually play football. And he was recruited. Yeah, he was recruited to play at CU for football, which he doesn't like to tell anybody.
And then all the secrets are coming out.
Because I was small and slow.
He was small and slow. And he showed up, and I think he got to practice or pre-practice or whatever before school started, and he was like, these are not my people. And I am small and slow. And back then, when I met him, he weighed 185 pounds and probably even less when you started. And whatever, he was small and slow, so he never actually played football.
No, I was like 205 in high school. But when I met you, I was already the biggest guy in the World Cup in slalom, and I was
187.
Wow.
It's a big difference.
And how much do you weigh now?
238. Thank you, CrossFit.
But I will also add, to actually answer your question, we started a nonprofit 12 years ago called Liquid.
Oh.
So we have kind of a history of wanting to like do things with kids, but it was, we took kids with HIV and AIDS on kayaking, like a week-long kayaking camp.
Okay. It's like an embodied leadership school.
And what's super cool about it is there actually became a point, because the medications and the mother-to-child transmission rate went down so much, it actually became like really hard for us to find kids to attend our camp.
Wow. Well, that means you're doing a good job.
Yeah, so when we started, it was like the kids were super sick. Mm-hmm. And, you know,
and kids died in between.
We had kids
die,
and like, you know, we'd have to wake them up in the middle of the night. We had a physician on our staff, but he would, you know, be administering medications all night long. And then towards the end, it's like these kids were showed up, and, you know, they were like jacked and playing high school sports and were not sick at all. And so just in that 10-year period we did that, it was really amazing what happened in the medical world in terms of medications for kids that already had were already HIV positive. And then it really became hard for us to find kids, because the mother-child transmission rate has gone down to like way less than 1% or something. So it was super cool that it was it ended for a really cool reason.
And that was nascent, I think, one of the first times we applied. We're like, hey, we're on to something here. Like the psychoneuroimmunology, which is the field of the interface between like pumping up serotonin and norepinephrine, like the whole system of like, get some vitamin D, get scared.
Yeah. Right?
And our kids were having really good blood tests. And it was interesting. You know, we were like, hey, this river community, this thing is really powerful to us. And we knew sort of about the science and we had this experience, and it was the first time, I think, where we said, okay, let's take the principles that we're using at this highest level of sports and performance, hey, this community, this thing, and let's apply it across cohort. And that really, you know, as a nascent model, it really is what we just continue to do today with, you know, stand-up kids.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about stand-up kids. So obviously you have addressed a lot of needs with Mobility Wad across the board, right? But and over the last few years, standing desks are becoming commonplace common in the workplace. But what first interested you in addressing this in schools or addressing this with kids?
Well, I'll tell you, we were actually kind of embarrassed that it occurred to us. it started when we were volunteering at Georgia's Field Day, and we always volunteer at the sack race for whatever reason. We think it's cool. Mm-hmm. And
hip extension, triple extension.
And triple extension. Duh. And we noticed that a lot of the kids at our kids' elementary school literally lacked the range of motion to get their foot into the sack.
Wow.
And then also really couldn't jump
Lunch
effectively.
Test.
They couldn't really jump effectively in the sack. And we would try to make the sack race difficult. Like, you had to do a forward roll midway through. And, like, most of the kids couldn't do a forward roll. And we just saw, we saw at all ages, as low as first grade. And this is not a group of kids who are super, you know, there's not a lot of obesity where we live. Mm-hmm. So we were like, what's going on here?
Before you go on, let me piggyback that when we were working on Ready to Run, we noticed that Georgia's class, and Georgia was in the first grade at the time, and one of the things we noticed was that all the kids came in running beautifully. They ran ball of the foot, mechanically perfect. They looked like Usain Bolt, right? And then
they all just sprint for the playground without warming
and
up.
They pull.
They just run.
Like,
they
you
pull.
Can't, you, it's miraculous. Halfway through the first grade, half the kids start heel striking.
Huh.
And we're like, the kids come home from Christmas break and ask for heel striking for Christmas. Look, but, you know, they were bad and they got heel striking. So, you know, we have both of these phenomena we've witnessed. So we're like, wow, what's going on with these kids? And then it occurred to us, because we had been like lecturing at Google and talking to a lot of big corporations about the problems of sedentariness and the mechanical problems inherent with sitting. And then we literally were like, oh, you know what? I can't believe it's taken us this long to realize that if we're going to get ahead of this, we have to start earlier.
Right.
You know, early education. I mean, like, yeah, this like is, you've heard, we were like, you know, oh, yeah, we're so stupid.
You've heard the phrase, you know, it's like a buzzword, sitting is the new smoking.
Right.
And,
right.
You know, obviously the way that we've reduced smoking in this country is to obviously try to, you know, help adults stop smoking. But the big campaign is to try to get people to stop doing it before they become addicted. And right. So that's kids. And we were like, oh, you know.
Best offense, no be there.
How did this not occur to us? Like, we were actually kind of embarrassed.
Well,
and when
and really,
we realized.
This is the crux of public health. Mm-hmm. You know, we're really. So the short of it is that it occurred to us. We, you know, went to the principal. We you should have seen. Juliet is an attorney, little mm-hmm. known fact. And she was also won the award at her school for, like, best litigator, best arguer, or arguments. And we were like, okay, we're going
to
crush. Oh, yes.
I seriously, like, I went to this meeting with the principal, and I was like, I'm going to have these PowerPoints ready, and I'm going to be preparing my Supreme Court argument.
Right.
Like, I'm going to come telling, I'm going to explain to this lady, like, this is why we need to switch to standing desks. And we said, like, four sentences, and I had, like, 500 things, other things prepared to say. Mm-hmm. And after, like, four sentences, she's like, I'm in. Great idea.
That was easy.
Yeah. So the other thing that happened, I have to just interject, is after we saw this at our kids' school, I started doing some research and I found this rudimentary calorie counter for it was for adults, not for kids.
Okay.
But I calculated for myself that if I switched from sitting to standing just 5 days a work week, 8 hours a day, mm-hmm. that I would burn an additional 90,000 calories a year.
Wow.
And then I went back and I was like, well, I wonder how many calories I'd burn as a 40-year-old woman running a marathon. And it was like an average of 3,300 calories. And I was like, holy shit, I could either run 33 marathons or I could just stand at my desk for 8 hours a day. And I'm like, honestly, I'd rather just stand at my desk. You know, and I don't really have a typical office job, but it was really like I posted it on Facebook. I was like, I can't believe this. I figured, you know, I couldn't believe it. And that was a second point where I was like, okay, well, maybe kids aren't burning as many calories, but they've got to be burning more mm-hmm. standing versus sitting. And that was really the first light bulb for me where I was like, hey, maybe this actually could have an impact on childhood obesity.
And if you go in and look at the research now, because we went in saying, hey, we could collect some qualitative data. Like, we don't want to do the research because that's not who we are, no researchers. But it turns out there are researchers that we've become friends with mm-hmm. in this process, and the data is really good. And it turns out that kids who are normal size, average body size, can burn an additional 17 to 20% more calories a day at a desk.
Wow.
17 to 20%.
A standing desk.
Kids who are high body mass index and are obese, upwards of 30%.
Or wow. 30, even 35%.
So go ahead and try to pull out the number of calories out of some kid's diet. Just try to do that. I mean, does it work? Ask the Obama administration. How's that going for you? How's the war on childhood obesity? Try.
Right.
NFL's Play 60. And I think what we're looking at, we're doing it wrong. It's all this reductionist. Instead, what do we change about the infrastructure? Mm-hmm. And what we saw was that it took the older kids, our fourth graders, it took them about 2 weeks where they were like, oh, I'm kind of tired. And we're like, yeah, you're weak.
Right.
You know, you can't.
Right.
You
sitting.
Know? And it's important to notice because people are, the one hang up people have is they're like, well, you know, I don't think it's good that they're standing. And we're like, they're not soldiers or cashiers.
Right.
The desk actually has a bar at the bottom that pivots.
Okay.
And it's adjusted to their height. So each desk fits a kid individually, which is remarkable. And when you see the disparity between the high desk and low desk, you're like, holy crap.
There are literally kids in George's class, fourth grade. There's some girls that are 5'6", mm-hmm. and there are boys who are literally 4'1", and they're all in fourth grade. And so when you go now, after we've gotten used to these desks that are like perfectly adjusted for kids, and we go into these sitting classrooms, it actually looks ridiculous. Like, there's a kid at our fifth grade, in our fifth grade class last year, 6 feet tall.
Wow.
And then he's in there with literally kids who are like low fours, and they're all sit, you know, he's literally crammed. I mean, it looks, after you see it and look at it from that perspective, it's embarrassing.
So we came out, you know, when we started doing the research, the physiology was clear, the impacts on, you know, cortisol, engagement, all of that. We came at it clearly from our wheelhouse, which is orthopedics.
Mm-hmm.
Show me, make the case for sitting. Like, you can't stabilize the spine effectively. You can't be organized. If you look and, you know, kids are slouching. But the point is that you walk into any classroom and let's look at the spines and just tell me that's okay. And especially since we started to pull in the brain science of skill acquisition, mm-hmm. we know that practice makes permanent.
Yeah.
Right? And so the way we do one thing is the way we do everything. So if you start to map this pattern in your brain, those oligodendrocytes come in. Remember that? Right?
Vaguely.
Schwann cells. Yeah. And you basically see myelination through those pathways. And those become default pathways.
And for the rest of us, what you're saying is practice makes permanent.
Right. Well, the point is in the brain, there's a biologic process that happens where we codify and make permanent the changes of patterns. And people don't understand that. So, you know, Mo is over there bent over looking at his phone with a 90 degree in his head. And the problem is that this is a learned position and very difficult to break. You know, so one of the cool things about all this, besides the side added benefit of increased engagement, is what the research says. Increased, you know,
and it's not just a little bit. Like the research is showing that there's something like 12% more engagement, which is like 7 minutes per hour or 45 minutes to an hour a day. So I mean, if you start to add that up over a whole school year, it's huge. It's actually it's a lot of time of kids actually learning, as opposed to just, you know, punching their neighbor or whatever they're doing.
You don't get the postprandial narcolepsy where you come in after lunch and you're like fall asleep.
Yeah, it's interesting that kids have said like they have their own vocabulary to describe what they like about it, but some of the kids are like, yeah, I just don't talk all the time anymore. And other kids say, like, I don't know why. I just feel happier. And it's really funny to hear from the kids, you know, from their perspective. And then, you know, on the orthopedics thing, there's one interesting story. Our first grade teacher who got the standing desk last January went to this handwriting. It was like handwriting specialist or something.
She's an occupational therapist.
Yeah, and she had all the teachers there sitting and basically was trying to prove the point that in a sitting desk, it's literally impossible for kids to have good handwriting. Hmm. And she said, look.
Proximal stability, distal mobility, right?
Yeah, she's literally like, it's impossible. And, you know, sort of throughout, like, you know, kids and adults can actually write with better handwriting standing up. And our first grade teachers would be like, she was so excited to like raise her hand and be like, my kids all stand up. and the OT was shocked. She was like, oh my God, I can't. She was like, this is amazing. Tell me more. Like, this is the first I've ever heard of this.
And kids, you know, the modern classroom is set up and it's in rows. It's not very conformable. Mm-hmm. So we put casters on the desks. They can be reconfigured. And so the room becomes very dynamic. Kids make circles. They push all the desks aside. They have this playroom, mm-hmm. this organizing. They reconfigure. There's no
Sounds
front
like
of the
fun.
Classroom. It is.
It's fun.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
And, you know, out of that also is that kids, you know, teachers are working in about 15-minute blocks. So mm-hmm. kids really stand only about 15 minutes in a chunk at a time. And at any time, kids can sit on the floor. So it's not like they're stuck. And so what you've done is what Juliet calls a movement-rich environment. Mm. And so what you see is you see in poverty, because if you sit, there are very few movement options. But as soon as you stand, you put one foot up, you put the other foot up, you can sit on the ground. And even just that range of motion is a radical change. So fast forward, we have a few classrooms.
So this started at your kid's school. And now, you started with just a couple of classrooms.
One classroom.
We started with
one
classroom, and then last August, and then we went up. We added on three more classrooms, so the entire fourth grade, and then one first grade.
Okay.
What's interesting about the first graders is they, you know, we put five stools in every class. So even though there's 20 to 25 kids, you know, mm-hmm. there are these stools if they feel like they need to use them. The first graders really never went for the stools, mm-hmm. Which we, again, not science, but our conclusion was that they hadn't become as accustomed to sitting all the time.
Right.
So it was easier for them. You know, they had been in preschool pretty recently. It was easier for the first graders to just switch right to a standing desk. And so, you know, you'd walk right in and they'd just be standing there and they were fine.
If you look at the technology coming in, you know, one of the problems that the classroom, the school district was trying to solve was, how do we get kids individualized around the keyboard and mousing and the ergonomics?
Right.
But it turns out that's not the problem. The tech isn't the problem. The problem is us. And so if you make the environment fit us, then all of a sudden kids are in what we call a blocked position. So, for example, when we teach burpees to people and we don't want their feet to collapse, right, we say put your feet together. So you have to have your feet together, burpee. And that automatically protects your ankles, blocks you, can't see the knee wobbliness. And so if you put kids at a stand-up desk, all of a sudden they're inoculated from tech snack and bad positioning because you can't do it. You can't slouch. And that's important because tech's not going away.
You see them, they lean on the desk, but it's interesting because they're in a pretty neutral spinal position when they're leaning, but, you know, it's like right when they sit down. It's that C
broken
shape. It's the
rainbows.
Dreaded broken rainbow.
So we met up with this really great organization called Donors Choose.
Okay.
And Donors Choose is basically a crowdsourcing innovation, a revolution in how to fund schools. And basically any teacher can propose a project on Donors Choose, and it can be very specific. I need these six paintbrushes, I need this book, I need this MakerBot. And then a person can go in, or someone can go in and fund the project, and the 100% of the proceeds literally go to that, and you can also donate a little bit more onto Donors Choose to support the network. They are in 70% of the lower income schools in America, and they saw that this was a real disruptive way. And they had also seen classrooms that hadn't been funded for stand-up desks. You know, people, teachers were like, we want this, but people were like, yeah, it's more important they have pencils. You know, screw the little kids.
Well, and that really sort of has turned out to be true. There is, and our principal was sort of an example of this, but in our experience so far, educators are really excited about this and they're ready for something different. You know, they have kids that are squirming and not paying attention and they're ready for an alternative to the classic, classroom design. So when I first started this, I thought, I'm really going to have to convince all these teachers and educators that this is a good idea. Well, that has turned out not to be the problem at all. Educators are like on board. They want this. Like, there is way more demand than we have funding for. So really the challenge has been and will be, I think, for us is convincing funders, because I think the issue with some funders is they think, it's public school, because this is all for public schools.
Right.
And, you know, the perception is, public schools don't even have pencils. You know, they're so bad off that, like, a standing desk is a frivolous expense in their minds.
Right.
And we really feel like it's our job to start to explain to funders that, you know, actually this whole physical inactivity thing is a public health crisis. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is really, at $250 a desk and hopefully less moving forward, it's a really simple intervention that can make a huge difference for kids. So, but that's a process.
Yeah.
Right.
And what's great is that this was driven by the educators. So one educator at a time, eventually every teacher in the school was like, us next. So they voted for it. We went to Donors Choose, proposed the project. It's the single biggest project in Donors Choose history.
Wow.
And we funded the school. And now our daughter, this August, will be at the first all-standing school in the world.
That we had something incredible. Like 850 donors on Donors Choose. I mean, it was by far the largest number of donors that have ever donated to a single project. And we raised $110,000. So August 17th, 350 desks are showing up at our kids' school, and every kid there will be standing.
And
that is amazing.
Shameless plug, we asked our friends to get involved. Some amazing people got involved. Mm-hmm. Killcliff ponied up.
Okay.
Love those guys.
Wow.
Tim Ferriss said, hey, I'm involved. Put his money where his mouth was, talked about it, actually made a personal donation to it. And we really feel like, you know, this is us actually doing what we say we're doing, because our business is about taking what we think are the best concepts out of sport and high performance and trying to spin those essence back to things that actually matter.
Right.
You know, like, let's take what we're learning from the CrossFit Games and apply it to my kids and to this Olympian and this injured person. And if we really are true to that model, then if we don't take this idea and then scale it backwards, then we're, you know, all of this is just circus. You know,
right.
Like,
right.
Let's just, you know, we'll break people and throw their bodies to the lions. But we're really proud of this. And I will point out that Juliet's work on standupkids.org, the actual website itself, is profound. The website is the best thing we've done so far. Even though it's Juliet's baby, the number of PDFs and infographics on there, it's really a resource. We want to try to clear the way and create a template for people to be able to do this in their own communities. It's amazing.
That is amazing. And I hope that it will continue and people will start to follow in your footsteps and we'll see more schools doing this. Where do you think the funding is going to come from? Do you think that we can find enough funding through public schools, or do you think it's going to have to come from outside donors or communities supporting the schools in their area?
I think it's all of the above. I mean, I think our next big, now that we've gotten this pilot school funded, our next big focus is to try to get long-term corporate sponsors, high net worth individuals. And I think no matter what, it's always going to have to be, because we've partnered with Donors Choose, it's always going to be every project is going to be crowdfunded. Mm-hmm. But our real goal is to try to raise $1 million matching grant so that every time a standing desk project gets posted, 50% of it is automatically funded from our matching grant. When I think the matching grant will mostly come from corporate donors.
Okay.
So we want to try to chunk out, you know, some bigger donations from corporations who see, you know, the long-term worth of this. And then, I mean, honestly, eventually my hope is that the federal government is going to take notice. Because at a minimum, whenever they build a new school, we think that should just be the default of standing desks. There's still money going into public schools and, you know, for example, our district, standing desks won't be covered for this, but we just passed this huge bond to do all these infrastructure upgrades at all the local schools because they all were built in the 40s and 50s. Mm-hmm. And I hope when those kinds of things happen at schools, that's another opportunity for some of those funds to go into standing desks. So, you know, I think it's going to have to come from a variety of sources.
Right.
And we see really our role as educating donor. I mean, you know, more than anything else, we now see our role as educating donors mm-hmm. and funders and trying to get as many corporate high net worth individuals on board and backing this.
And so, this is really, I think, a good example of communitarianism. Mm-hmm. You know, let's solve the community. It's you can crowdsource this quickly and easily, solve the community yeah. from without. And the number of problems we're putting off, I personally think that this is the number one cause of the root source of all the ACL dysfunction we see in female athletes, because you can't, you know, speaking personally, our oldest daughter, Georgia, we just watched her starting twist and twist and twist and twist, and we'd work on her, and mm-hmm. she'd work on the, you know, I took her to see a Rolfer, and then as soon as she stopped sitting, she started to untwist. I mean, it was horrible. Like, she started walking like a duck and, like, became valgus, and we were just like, ah! You know, and I think that's related 100% to that sitting posture. So, you know, if we just evaluate the success and the merits of this thing based solely on is this a good position or bad position, then it's clear. I mean, I think, you know, I mean, plus right. plus the physiology, plus the research. So
there's so many things that can be prevented just from this one.
Well, you know, if we take a real crack at sedentariness, mm-hmm. you know, this is really, you know, people don't realize how much sitting time they're aggregating in the course of the day. Right. And the research is that kids, independent of socioeconomic class, back me up, Jay, what, 9 to 11 hours on the screen?
It's 7, and Kaiser did this huge study. It's mm-hmm. 7.5 hours a day on average screen time.
Wow.
So if you add that to school, that's not at school.
Cause not at school either.
No, so that's like, you know, school's 4 to 6 hours, 7.5 hours on a screen. I mean, that's, you know, the only other sort of question we've gotten from parents or criticism has been like, well, I sat in the 70s or 80s and 90s, and I'm fine.
Right.
No, you're not.
That's one of those things like people say with nutrition. One, they don't realize how bad they're feeling until they start to eat well and feel good again. It's probably the same thing with
standing. Yeah, it is. And it's one of those things where I'm like, yeah, but, you know, when I grew up, it was like the only time I sat was at school, and I never sat at any other time except for meals. And now, you know, kids are sitting, and there's also a lot of other things. Kids don't walk to school anymore. Mm-hmm. They're assigned way more homework than they were when we were kids. So there's just like, you know, it's aggregated, not walking, sitting all the time, screen time, so much homework. Kids being driven everywhere they go, it's like, you know, they're just, it's a huge deal. I mean, we estimate kids are sitting 85% of their day. You know, Australia did this huge comprehensive study that said that your chance of dying by any cause is significantly increased, like 50 to 75% if you sit more than 6 hours a day. And that's actually really hard. I've tracked my own sitting, you know, and I have a standing desk. Obviously, I don't have a normal desk job anymore, so I'm moving around all the time. But even still, it's like we have a 30-minute to-from work commute, so that's an hour. Mm-hmm. We actually do sit while we eat meals. Mm-hmm. That's like combined an hour, hour and a half, or whatever. And it's actually, you know, you should try it sometime. And I know you're in school, too, so that makes it even worse. But it actually is hard, even for like the most, because we're so focused on sitting culture, it's actually hard not to sit less than 6 hours a day.
There's this
unless you're so focused on it.
And, and those of you people who are listening who have boys, there's this element that you need to listen to. There's a great book called Raising Cain mm-hmm. that's looking at the educational disparities and differences in achievement between boys and girls. And boys are getting their butts kicked by girls right now.
Really?
It's partly because boys have a larger genetic drive
to
move.
Sorry to interrupt, but like in every statistic, like test scores, graduation rates, college admissions, college graduations. I mean, like, girls are just crushing, which is awesome on some level.
Right,
of course.
On some level, but
yeah. I have daughters, it's fun. But what we're finding out is that, you know, books like David Epstein's The Sports Gene, mm-hmm. it turns out there's a large genetic component and genetic drive to move. And what's happening is that kids aren't getting to be able to express that, and the boys act out, get in trouble, bad reinforcement starts right. to happen. You know, there was, we had a you know, as we delve into the scary realm of ADD and ADHD mm-hmm. related issues, we had a young family that came to us and said, hey, we're really concerned about this because we have trained for the last 8 years, trained our daughter to be able to sit at a desk and focus. And she is diagnosed ADD, ADHD and ADD. And we're like, we're just really concerned that this same thing. And we're like, great. If it doesn't work out, she can sit down. And lo and behold, you know, she thrived in the program. Likes
well,
the desk,
and a bunch of new research just came out that kids with ADHD literally can't learn unless they're in motion. And this is not like they don't need to be running. I mean, it can be these little micro movements, mm-hmm. but literally their brain does not turn on unless they're moving a little bit. So like, it's like death for a kid like that to force them to sit still. Right. You know, they literally can't function.
You're just not designed. You're not designed to be static. So it's important that people are understanding. We're not saying that standing still is the answer. Standing is a gateway to more movement. And if you can fidget and put your foot up, like right now I'm kind of fidgeting. I'm putting my leg, fidgeting. And I think that's really what's happening. And this is such an elegant, hardwired solution. You don't have to believe in it. It believes in you. You don't have to buy into some system. Better engagement, calories burned. I mean, whatever is important to you.
And of course we care about nutrition and exercise. We're not saying throw those out and that standing desks are, you know, you can't eat 10,000 calories a day, never exercise, and just think you're going to be skinny and fit if you sit at a standing desk. I mean, that's not
whatever
what we're saying
you have.
At all.
You have abs. That's not true.
I try to exercise sometimes, but you know, that's
so
I
guys exercise
a few times. So you know, it's one of those things where it's like, you know, people are like, well, what about nutrition and exercise? Right. And we're sort of like, yeah, of course, like it's got to be all those things, and we certainly are never going to say that like standing desks are the end all be all, but we do think they're really simple, really easy to implement, really easy to control, because it's really hard to control people's diet and hard to control how much or if they exercise.
Absolutely.
And it's not hard to control whether your kid goes to school and stands at a standing desk.
One of my favorite pieces of research from Dr. Mark Benden, Texas A&M, who's done a lot of good longitudinal research about following 500 kids, and his work is really some of the seminal work here. And he said, hey Kelly, do you know what the number one design implication and thought is about making chairs for kids at school? I'm like, what? And he's like, do they stack for the janitors?
Wow.
And when you're like,
that's the only consideration.
Wow. And you're like, that's,
you know, it's not, they're not even like the Herman Miller Aeron chair, which is like scientifically designed to be perfect for your body. I mean, these chairs are literally like, can they stack and be easily moved around by the janitor?
Wow.
Done.
That is incredible. Yeah. Wow.
It's sort of like, you're like, and once you see this, you know, Caroline's teacher in the first grade, she's like, look, you just have to see it. We had some camera crews come out from schools, and literally the guy's like, so did you prep them? And they're like, no, they're like this. And the kids just work and they move around and quiet. And he's like, this is revolution. And it works. It just works.
That is awesome.
And if you're an adult, this is crucial to understand. Takeaway. It's not a standing station and have a place to put your foot. So if you've ever, there are these places, Julie, I don't know if you've ever heard of them. They're called bars. Like pubs.
Oh, really?
And at the bottom of the pub.
Never been to one.
She's been in medical school. She hasn't had a chance.
That's right. There's this thing called the bar, right?
Okay.
The rail.
Right.
You put your foot up on the rail.
It's actually called a bar, not a rail.
No, it's the rail at a bar.
Okay.
There's a rail at the bottom of the bar, right? And it turns out that even bartenders figured this out. And if people came in and stand around, you can test this yourself. Mm-hmm. Do some bunch of deadlifts and then go to a bar and stand around. You'd be like, oh, my back hurts. This beer isn't very good.
Right.
You know, that girl's not very cute. Put your foot up. Shing, and you can be like, dude, let's stay here.
Yeah, I can
really
stand here for like 8
so
hours.
Comfortable. That girl's so
that's
hot.
That's a secret. I actually did not know that. I've used a standing desk for quite a while. I have one at home, and played around with different setups, but I have not done that.
So what ends up happening?
And
people stand.
It doesn't need to be fancy. Yeah. I mean, you know, it could be like an Amazon box or two. I mean, you know, just something to get your foot up and be able to alternate one foot up.
Takes
one
all
foot
the
down.
Extension. Takes all the extension. Load. That's why we split jerk.
Right.
Right. So as soon as you take that extension load up, I mean, the Captain Morgan pose is a meme, but he's right.
Wow.
you don't have to flex per se or do whatever he's doing.
You can if you want to.
You can. Well, that's optional. But it turns out it's not a standing station to have a place to put your foot, and that's what's crucial, because once people do that, they're like, wow, I can really stand here all day.
Wow. So. Obviously, that's something that is easy. Kids can do at school. I want to go over maybe a few tips for parents, too, just at home. How do you address at home your kids' mobility or things that you can do to help prevent bad habits from happening early on?
Easy thing. Limit sitting. So we have a great Russian coach at our gym who's very severe in her methodologies.
Okay.
And she was like, sitting is bad. So she got rid of her couch. And I was like, you know.
It's a little extreme.
That's
a little extreme. Yeah. Like, we still want to be part of like a civilized culture.
And frankly, couches look good in living rooms.
They do.
So for example, our kids aren't allowed to be on tech and to flex. So we were like, hey, if you're in a bad position, get one warning. If you're in a bad position, the iPad goes away. So really, like, our kids become little ninjas about that.
Yeah.
And that's just taught. Hey, you brush your teeth. This is how you hold technology. Two, our kids sit on the floor all the way, or they sit on the couch all the way, like cross-legged.
Okay.
They don't sit on the couch and dangle. And automatically you see different mechanisms around that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what's great about mobility restrictions with kids is that if kids aren't engaged in play, there are very few restrictions. Mm-hmm. You know, they're barefoot. You know, we have our kids wear flat shoes. This is a biggie. We can't stress that enough for foot development and development.
Well, but, can I just interject? Yeah. I think another big thing is like sort of changing your cultural mindset that like certain things need to be done sitting down. Like we had a mom come up to us and she's like, oh my God, I have been fighting with my kids to sit still while they're doing their homework. And she's like, and we have a counter now and they just stand there and do their homework because that's actually how they feel more comfortable. But she's like, it's trying to put like a square peg in a round hole. She's like, I've been trying to get them like, sit still, do your homework. And she realized that that was just some cultural construct.
Right.
And so it's a little bit like Caroline, our littlest kid, she just doesn't really fit in our dining room chairs that well. Mm-hmm. So she often will just stand there and eat dinner. And I mean, you know, obviously, if we're eating with the queen, the rules would be different. But I mean,
really.
On a day-to-day basis, that's actually, she's more comfortable. She doesn't really fit in an adult-sized chair. So she'll just stand there often and have dinner. And so I think part of it is just sort of changing your mentality about like what's expected.
Right.
And like certain things you think, oh, I have to sit to be doing that. Mm-hmm. You don't, you know, a kid can sit at home. And I mean, another big thing we do is like, you know, we walk to and from school. Mm-hmm. I mean, realize that it doesn't have anything to do with standing
exercise activity but is underrated. You cannot just drive to school and then do soccer, you know, 3 days a week. You like, people are not moving enough. And that goes for kids,
adults,
athletes,
non-exercise
activity.
There's so many people who just work. They think they're good because they've worked out 1 hour a day, but then they sit for all the remaining hours. And that counts as a sedentary lifestyle. Like, even if you CrossFit for an hour a day and then sit for the rest of the day, you have a sedentary lifestyle. And people don't like hearing that, but, like, that's the, like, scientific and medical fact of it is that, you know, you have a sedentary lifestyle. Yeah. And it's the same for kids. So I think just paying attention as a family to how much sitting time there is and trying to curb it however you can with that's walking to school or, you know, making sure your kid stands when they're doing their homework or whatever. I think there's a lot of little things that can be done.
No tech in the bedroom. There should be no phone in the bedroom.
That's great.
No computer in the bedroom. No screen in the bedroom. It's because it wakes you up and it's not good. And then, you know, kids react really fast to soft tissue changes. And so, like, our kids are on a steady diet of the couch stretch. Mm-hmm. You know, their anterior hip, it gets short, and we couch stretch a ton, and it works really well. And then for Georgia, we sit, watch TV, and do the middle splits.
That's the other thing, too, I mean, this is not about standing desks, but I was very influenced by this joke of an article that came out 2 years ago that was entitled, How Do You Give Your Kids a 1970s Summer?
Okay.
And it was this, it's
drink
hilarious.
Drink from the hose.
It was a hilarious thing. It was like, go outside, don't come back till it's dark. Thirsty? Yeah. Drink from the hose. You know, all that kind of stuff that, like, we actually did. Like, we would be gone until it was dark. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, I haven't implemented it, like, to the same extreme. But I have gotten a little stricter. Like, you know, if I'm bored, go outside.
Right.
Go do something outside. Go find some neighbor kids. Go play outside. Go outside.
We read this New York Times.
And then I'm like, you're not allowed to come back inside. You know?
We read this New York Times article, and it was, like, comparing modern children in terms of how, like, capable they were. And there's a kid in Peru at age 3 could hunt an animal, kill it, skin it, cook it.
Like, cook it for his tribe.
Wow.
And from that day forward, we were like, nope, not tying your shoes. Good luck with that.
figure it out.
I think this is really about skill development, but also just looking at, you know, what is the best environment for that to happen. Mm-hmm. And when you start to get organized around that, it's really, really easy to make small changes. Small and what we're talking about is physical practice. Mm-hmm.
You know. And I think just the awareness that physical inactivity is horrible for everybody, kids and adults alike, and being conscious of it. I mean, there's still a lot of days where I end up sitting more than 6 hours, mm-hmm. but then I'm always aware of it now. It's the same thing, like when you actually start paying attention to and tracking your nutrition, like you fall off the wagon every so often and eat a whole pizza and some ice cream, but then the next day you're back on it. And
no,
it's the same thing.
You're back off because you have diarrhea.
Yeah, it's true, right? You're messed up forever. But you know what I mean? It's the same kind of concept, except for thinking about, you know, how much non-exercise activity can I be getting in addition to my regular exercise? And, you know, how much am I sitting all the time?
Juliet and I start walking a 5K every morning.
Wow.
We're lucky as we have the time. It's about a little over a mile of school. We loop around, get coffee, loop back. And we're
that
like,
sounds
wow.
wonderful.
We're like, wow, this is amazing.
Wow.
You know? But, you know, we still, like, we do that, and we're still, like, at our office by 9:15. I mean, it's not like, you know, we're not
right.
We're not just showing up at noon after we take this 5K walk. I mean, you know.
You're moving on your
5K. We're moving. Yeah.
Wow. Well, that's incredible. I think those are some great tips, too, that people can take home and try to use with their own kids. But I want to conclude with 3 questions that I ask everyone about health in general. So first one, and you can answer together if you want. First one is 3 things that you guys do on a regular basis that have the biggest overall positive impact on your health.
Sleep. We prioritize sleep. It's such a big deal.
How much do you guys sleep per night?
I need to sleep like 9 hours, ideally. Mm-hmm. I usually sleep like 8, but as long as it's 8 to 9 hours, I'm good. So we try to do 8 to 9 hours.
I'm with you on that one.
Yeah, sleep I think is the hugest thing. And I think we our latest thing has been trying to add in as much non-exercise activity because we're just like it's part of our habit in life to train, like formal training.
Right.
But I think even we've fallen into a bad trap sometimes of like formal training and then sitting around all the time. So I think that's been another huge thing is really being conscious of like, hey, it's fine if I train, but what other non-exercise activity am I going to be getting all day?
It's a good way to think about it.
Yeah.
I fall into that group.
Yeah.
A lot of times.
Yeah. It's hard. It's really, you know, it's like we think, oh, we're so healthy. We're training. Right. But
it's just something else that will really change people's lives. Get their phone out of the bedroom. You got to get out of your bedroom.
Yeah.
You can't look at it before you go to bed. Mm-hmm. You can't wake up first thing. Like, it's wrecking the quality of your sleep. So we talk a lot about sleep hygiene. Your room needs to be black. It needs to be cold. You need to drop your core temperature down. It should be quiet. And you cannot have a phone in there. Quit it. We even have a red alarm clock. You know, an old-fashioned,
like, Walgreens for, like, $12?
Like the ones with the big bells on top?
Pretty much. You can't see it in the dark. It's totally fine. What time is that? I have no idea. But, I mean, those things, I think, you know, we really, really, those things have made a
Yeah, I would say two
impact.
Or three of those are, like, sleep and sleep hygiene, and then just trying to move more.
Exercise more.
Yeah.
How about, you guys are really good at all of this, but is there one thing that you think would have a big impact on your health, but you haven't been able to implement it yet, or you're trying to figure out a plan?
We are working and always talking about trying to get in meditation or breathing practice.
We suck at that. I mean, we know it would be good for us, and we want to do it, and we like even try to block out time, and then somehow like that gets lost.
Right. There's always something that seems more important.
Yes.
Right?
Well, there's a lot of things going on. You know, some soft tissue helps with the down regulation, but the and we're exercising, so we're seeing breathing good stuff. But I think. We've recently been introduced to this guy named Wim Hof, who has a very simple meditation, but it's a mechanical breathing practice.
Okay.
And it is tremendous. Very simple. And, you know, you can do these breathing exercises in like 12 minutes. And it's one of those things I'm like, I know you don't have 12 minutes. You just don't. Right. And sometimes it's tricky. You know, drop off the kids, you got to run. Yeah. But I say that's the one thing that we struggle to get better at.
I'm with you on that one, too. I did it for a while, then dropped
off. Fell off the wagon.
Yeah. I got it back on with that one.
Yeah. I think that's important. But I think it's a mechanical breathing practice. Mm-hmm. I think you don't have to be, Zen. You just need to do this thing.
Right. And as long as you have some structure, something like that, that's 12 minutes, you know you can do it. That's great. Last question. What does a healthy life look like to you?
Play. We love to play.
Play.
We run through everything through one filter around business, friends, things we do. Are we going to be together as a family plan? You know, does this get us closer to like taking a trip as a family and being on the river or boating? You know, we've just come out of a really difficult, long period of this hard incubation around entrepreneurship and businesses and growth. And our kids are just old enough now. We're like, whoa, like I just did a big race, big paddle race. I've had time to train for it. Juliet's training for the World Championships in September Outrigger Canoe.
Wow.
And, you know, to continue to just get outside. Mm-hmm. Like, we love to ski. We bike. If we're on vacation, this sounds totally nerdy. We're such nerds. Like, our dream is, like, we get up and we ski with our kids and we come back and we nap and then we train. Like, we're
such
like two days.
We love it.
Sounds great.
When we're on vacation, we don't, like, lay around by the pool.
Right.
Like, We're like, yes, we get to train, and we actually slept enough, so we feel really good, you know. But yeah, I mean, for me, I think a lot of it is like, can I like jump on my mountain bike and bike for 2 hours today? Just even if I haven't mountain biked in 6 months, or you know, I have time to, you know, like my happy place is like outside in the wilderness, you know. So am I creating time and space to be able to do that?
My numbers have around the gym have really just they stopped really mattering a lot more. Mm-hmm. What matters is am I deadlifting yes or no? Right,
okay.
You know what I mean. So as long as there's something on the bar, and I'm less dogmatic about it, because I don't have to compete in deadlifting,
right?
So if I show up and like I need to pull today, but Juliet's like, hey, we're doing this pulling in a Metcon, I'm like, I'm in. Or if I show up and saw my friend Mark Brell, he's like, we're pulling heavy, I'm like, great, I'm in. As long as more important is about that. Am I being consistent in my movement practice, which is still very heavy in some of those things, right? Are we CrossFitting? Mm-hmm. But you know, really shifting back to. How am I using my fitness?
Get outside, learn to play new sports.
Get outside.
Weird how that was the fundamental piece. But you know, you have to put some time in to become skilled and fit.
Absolutely.
And then it takes a lot less to become skilled. You don't have to maintain working so hard. And frankly, this sounds totally like heresy, but I'm 41, almost 42. I'm not going to be the best in the world at CrossFit. So one of the things is, how strong do I want to be? Mm-hmm. You know, if I can power clean 315 comfortably, and I know I can squat 400, and I can deadlift 500, like, I'm actually, for me right now, I'm like strong enough. I'm much more interested in pulling 405 for a whole lot. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, you know, my values have changed a little bit just because I'm just not as driven by that.
I call it CrossFit for life.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm jumping on that.
You're jumping
now
on that.
I'm literally
like,
excited about it.
I do it like we laugh because we have some friends who like they ski and they're like, man, I haven't skied in so long. I'm out of shape. And like we ski and we're like, yeah, we're fine. Like, we're not sore when we go skiing. And then we actually still want to train after we go skiing.
And we ski 14 days in a row.
You know, yeah, it's because we've been training this way.
Right.
You know, so we're no longer trying to be like, I can do the most pull-ups or I can do this or whatever. And, you know, there's certain things in CrossFit, I'll be honest, like, I've given up on. Like, I don't care if I ever can do certain things mm-hmm. because I'm just like, that's not, you know, like, what I want to spend my time doing is being on my bike or being on rivers or skiing or doing whatever. And so I really that's why I call it CrossFit for life. It's like I really use it as like the basis to be able to do all the other stuff I want to do so that I know I can show up and do any of those things whenever I want and be fit and ready to go and not get crushed.
And I just did this Moloka crossing, which was like a 6.5 hour paddle race, but crazy. I came out unharmed. People were like, you didn't train very long for that. And I was like, well, I've only been training really hard for it for like 12 years. You know what I mean? Like really,
day,
really
yeah.
hard. But, you know, it was really great to not have to invest massive, massive, massive years to prepare for something because that's our base. And I'm so grateful for that experience to be able to do that, not be injured, come out unharmed, and just drop right on the bandwagon. I mean, that's what people understand. Like, you just got to put it in. And we're in this age cohort where we're seeing people dissolve around us. Mm. Have some kids, get into your 40s, yeah. be in your profession, and your health dissolves. And then the people freak out, and we're like, look, you can't. You just have to be consistent.
Right. Wow. Well, you guys are wonderful. Incredible, everything that you're doing. Thank
was that 30 minutes?
That was probably a little more than 30 minutes.
44.
But I enjoyed every minute of it. So thank you guys so much
thank
for sitting down
so
with me.
Thank you so much for having us, Julie.
Yes, and we'll have to do it again sometime.
Anytime.
Thank you, doctor.
Thanks, guys. Thank you all so much for tuning into this episode. You can learn more about Stand Up Kids at standupkids.org. There are a ton of awesome resources, tools, and infographics you can use there at your disposal. To make sure you never miss an episode in the future and to receive exclusive content from me, head to my website, juliefouché.com, and subscribe to my email list. Also, don't forget to share your stories. If you know someone who has used lifestyle to overcome a serious health challenge, or maybe you have yourself, please email me and tell me about it at info@juliefouché.com. I'll choose some of these inspiring stories to share here on the podcast in future episodes. If you like what you hear, don't forget to subscribe and give us a rating on iTunes. And I love to continue to hear your feedback, so please leave comments under this post on my website. Also, share your thoughts on social media using #JFHealth with any feedback or questions or ideas for future episodes. Thank you again so much for listening, and I'll catch you next time on Pursuing Health.